servant who does his prayer thing that he does so well. If you don't know, it's Pastor Appreciation Month, and so I just wanted to say thank you to Brother Perdue for all that he does, and have a special prayer for him. So if y'all would indulge me a little bit and hopefully send up your own prayers of gratitude, let us pray for Brother Perdue and Mary. God, I thank you so much that we are part of this congregation that is led by a man that you placed here for many, many different purposes, God. And I just thank you for Brother Perdue and what he has allowed you to do in his life and how he has allowed you to lead him and lead us, God. And so I just ask today that you give him a special blessing and that you give Mary a special blessing because she's just as much for us as he has. And I ask that you strengthen them and help them grow and help them move forward in their lives. And I hope, God, that they know how appreciated they are. And so I thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Kris. Someone asked me, week before last, I was speaking last Sunday. They said, how do you worship when you do all that you have to do? And I said, well, it is difficult because you're thinking, and what you're doing, you're thinking, you're in this, you've got to do that. And so we don't do a lot of worship on a Sunday morning, to be honest with you. And Kris doesn't either, because Kris is running here and there doing all those things. That's why we take vacations and time off. But so many of you enjoyed last Sunday. In my previous church, we did this at least four times a year. We had a Sunday when the women did all the service. We had a Sunday when the men, all men, did the service. We did a Sunday when the children did all the service. We had a Sunday when the youth did all the service, and then sometimes we just lay it each Sunday when everybody was involved. So we had a lot of lay people that were involved in the bedtime ministry. But it is a tremendous time to hear about lay people. And many times we actually had someone either from our congregation or from outside the congregation that would give a testimony. Almost every Sunday. And it was up there. And it was a tremendous Sunday. And I think those that spoke, I thank you, because that's not easy. You know, it's just not easy to stand up here and speak if you're not used to speaking. As we go to our Lord in prayer, you see those that we need to be praying for. That's not just for us now. That's for you to pray for them all week. Many of you got an email about Martha Paxton's granddaughter. Is her name Sahara? Sahara. Beautiful name. And she's 4 years old and she has cancer. This is a kind of cancer that just strikes children, young children. And we want to be in prayer for her. Our granddaughter's 4 years old. I can't imagine a child and a family going through that. So we want to be in prayer for her. Not only this morning, but throughout the weeks that lie ahead, she has to. You may have things that you want to bring to the altar. We invite you to do that. Let's be in prayer for our country in the upcoming election. And I never endorse anyone. I never have. You know, we get things in the mail. You know, all but government that says you don't endorse candidates, and I never have endorsed candidates. In fact, years ago, a governor was running for Tolliver running for governor. I got an invitation. Not invitation, but where he gave us the invitation that he was willing to come and speak at our church. And, you know, back to you. And I said, you know, we would love to have you come and speak at St. Andrew right after the election. And so I never heard from him again. So, but he was elected governor. But you know, I just don't do that. So that being said, let me encourage you to vote. You know, and be ready to vote. Make up your mind. I'm going to vote. That's a privilege that you have. And so let's come as we have all. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. We're waiting, Lord, for you to speak. We will hear. We will obey. And we will do what you tell us. And so, Lord, we have gathered here this morning with listening ears and a spirit that's ready to hear from you. We are not our own, but we have been bought by a tremendous price, the blood of Jesus Christ. So that's why we come here today and gather here today to worship Him, to praise Him, to love Him, and let Him love us. And so, Lord, we lift today these knees of today. We think of Sahara, Lord, and we just pray, Lord, that as doctors do what they do to make this little girl well, we just pray, Lord, that your healing hand would be upon her and upon them, as they make the decisions to do the right thing. Because, Lord, we know you work in many, many different ways. We just pray for the healing of having in your body. We give you praise for Gladys Conway, granddaughter. We thank you for the healing that has happened there. We do pray, Lord, for the needs that's gathered here at this altar today. Touch those needs, whatever they might be. It may be for themselves, it may be friends, it may be family, but Lord, do what needs to be done in their lives. We do pray, Lord, for America. Not only America, but for our world. We know, Lord, that things are not the way we want them to be, but probably they never are. They're never really good enough. Economic times are never really good enough. Things just aren't the way we want them. But Lord, now they're the way they are, and so we adjust and we do the best with what we have. We do pray, Lord, for our upcoming election. We just pray, Lord, that your Spirit move upon us to vote, and that is a privilege. Your word tells us, Lord, that nobody really wins an office without your approval. And Lord, we believe that, that you're in charge. And that's what that scripture is telling us, that you are the one that's really in charge. And so this prayer that we pray, the Lord's Prayer, reminds us, Lord, that you really are in charge. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those
At this time, let us join together in hymn 172, My Jesus, I Love Thee. We stand at your angle.
Thank you.
growth and discipleship. Sorry for the hurtful things we say and do. please forgive us. Help us remember to treat others with your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up this morning. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 3. So clean house, make a clean sweep of malice and pretense, envy and hurtful talk. You've had a taste of God. Now, like infants at the breast, drink deep of God's pure kindness. Then you'll grow up mature and whole in God.
Made mommy. That's what my granddaughter calls me when I discipline her. Made mommy. And Lord, it is good to be here today. To worship and to lift your name. What is it you have for us today, Lord? What is it? We're ready to receive it. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. And speaking of granddaughters, last spring we planted tomatoes and squash. And I took Haley and Connor out and I said, now, Connor, this is yours and Haley, this is yours. Haley is 4 years old. So Haley would run out every hour to check to see if her tomato plant was growing. Then she'd come back in and say, it's not growing. And she thought it should grow a little bit every hour. Now she loves tomatoes. She will eat two tomatoes. So she couldn't wait for those tomato plants to have fruit so she could eat them. Isn't Jesus like that with us? Jesus can't wait for us to have fruit and be fruitful. But sometimes it just takes us a long time. In our spiritual journey, in our spiritual walk, to bear fruit. But the expectation is that every one of us will reach a point spiritually that we bear fruit and we become fruitful Christians. We expect a plant to grow and have fruit, but it takes time. But here's some of the things that you have to give a plant, and they're almost the same things that you also have to give to us spiritually. First is this, got to have good soil. Good soil. The second thing is you gotta have water. We learned that this summer. If a plant does not have water, it will die. Got to have fertilizer. We didn't have the bananas. Got some chicken litter. Before we planted the tomatoes and the squash. And boy, does it make things grow. Now, it doesn't make you real popular with neighbors, but because for 2 weeks, do you have an odor? But it will make things grow. Marigold grows. So there's things, you know, that we do and prefer the old-fashioned organic type fertilizer. But make things grow. It's got to be fertilized. You must be cared for. You have to keep the weeds off, and you have to keep the bugs off, or it will choke everything out. And we know that in just a few days, if you don't keep the bugs off, they'll begin to wither and die. There has to be sunlight. The experts tell us, and there are experts, a garden has to have 6 hours of sunlight a day. Now, if it just has 4, it will never reach its full potential. Oh, you'll have some fruit, but not in its fullness. 2 hours, you'll just have a plant and no fruit. I want you to think about that. Isn't that true with the Son of God? If you don't have all of Him, you're not going to bear fruit. If you don't have all of His Spirit, you're not going to bear fruit. And so we have to. It'll never reach its expectation. Now let's look at our own spiritual growth, okay? And growth begins with salvation. Our salvation. That's the seed that's planted in our hearts. While I was working on this sermon this week, I ran across this. I haven't seen this before. But it's a definition for salvation. The word salvation means development toward perfection. Perfection means that you reach that point that you are at your best. Okay? You perform the best that you can possibly perform. You are at your best. Or it means birth into maturity. Now in the Greek, the word salvation is in a aorist passive tense, which means, when we translate that, it means that you are being saved, or you are in the process of being saved. That means it's not a final act, but it is a continuation of growing. So Peter says that you're growing your salvation. And doesn't that make sense? And that's what it does from the Greek. You're growing your salvation. You're watering it. You're fertilizing it. You're doing everything that you possibly can to make your salvation grow and mature and be everything that God wants it to be. So it begins with planting the seed. Now, where this begins is with the Holy Spirit coming to us, we call it new grace, coming to us and offering us salvation. And that's God's grace, mercy, and love. And because Jesus Christ died on the cross, rose again, He offers us salvation. I like our study that we're doing, one of the best I've seen on Wednesday night, about witnessing. And this lesson this week actually goes through the plan of salvation. And I heard a fellow speak. It was a layperson, wasn't a minister, but a layperson. And this fellow was going down the road one day, and he met upon an accident, and apparently he was the first one that was there. The car was overturned, the fellow was thrown out. So he ran down there to see if he could do anything. And didn't have telephones at that time, cell phones and all those type of things. It probably wouldn't work where he was anyway at that time. And he said, so he was the first one in there. He bent down and began talking to the fellow to see how he was. And he said he was badly injured, but he said the fellow asked him, "Are you a Christian?" And he said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Can you tell me how to become a Christian?" that could happen to any one of us. Every Christian ought to know how to lead someone to Jesus Christ. He couldn't say, well, let me call my pastor. Well, no, wait. There was no time. Time was crucial. The man knew that. And that's what I like about this study. This study tells you how to lead someone to Jesus Christ. And every one of us should, as Christians, be able to do that. Now let me say just a little bit more about that. As we grow and mature in our salvation, what happens is we reach a point spiritually that the Holy Spirit is so in tune with our spirit that if we could not remember everything that we're supposed to say, the Holy Spirit, now hear me clearly, the Holy Spirit will give us the words that we're to say. Okay? I have had that happen more and more in my life. I didn't know what to say in situations, and I would say the right thing, and I'd walk away from that situation, and I would think to myself, I am not that smart. I am not that smart. I did not have that up here, but I had it in here, and it came out here because it was coming from the Word. What it's all about. What it's all about. See? But we need to be so in tune, and we grow. We grow that. We grow to that point. The second thing is get rid of the means in your life. If you haven't gotten rid of the things that he lists here, you need to do it. You need to do it now. And he begins listing those things that if we don't get rid of them, it will make us unfruitful and unusable. Now, you've heard the saying, well, nobody likes a big mouth person. You ever heard that? That's what these things are. He says, get rid of malice, guile, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. Now, all of these are sins that's in our heart, but most of them come out of our mouths. Our mouths will usually tell us and other people what we are spiritually. Did you hear that? Our mouths will tell us where we are spiritually and everybody else. Sometimes I hear people talk, and I think to myself, people are doing this all the time now, if we could just film that, what they're saying, and play it back to them, they'd say, wow, I shouldn't really be saying that. That doesn't sound very Christian at all. But we don't always listen to what we're saying. So Peter said, get rid of all these things. Salvation must grow. We have to be fed spiritually. The third is this. Be grounded in the Word of God. That is your fertilizer. This is your water and this is your fertilizer. I don't know how many of you read the Bible daily. I have heard people say that I'm so busy I don't have time to read the Bible. Then you are really too busy. You really need to cut down on some things. You really need to change your lifestyle because if you have time to eat, you have time to read the Bible. Because the Bible is your through what has been planted. It brings up what has been planted. If you're reading the scriptures, you get a situation, you may not remember that verse, but all of a sudden that verse just pops up. It's in your mind. When I was in seminary, we had to memorize scripture after scripture, especially evangelism. And had one class, we actually had to memorize the book of John to the point that when someone would give a verse, we could tell where it was in the chapter and the verse. Folks, that is a lot of memorizing. But know the Word of God. Study the Word of God. And it's quite interesting when he says that we should desire and hunger after reading the scriptures, just like a baby desires milk. Hungers after milk. What he's telling us is that we should reach a point spiritually. That when we get up in the morning, the most important thing is not your coffee, not your breakfast, not anything else. But there's a hunger as to read the Word of God. And that's what you want to do. What is done, that's what he's telling us that we have to do. Fourth is this. The Christian must be caring for. They must be with people that will care for them and tell them the truth about themselves. Do you want to know the truth about yourself? This keeps us on track spiritually. This keeps us where we need to be. If somebody really loves you, they'll care for you. And they'll really tell you the truth about yourself. Now, what happens generally when somebody tells us the truth about ourselves? What happens? We get angry. You're judging me. How can you say that? Quite interesting. John Wesley said this, that we need to be in small groups and be held accountable for the things that we do, but also for the things that we don't do. So all these years ago, Wesley had it right according to the scriptures. Fifth is this. You must have the Holy Spirit. You must have the Holy Spirit. Now this leads me to next week's sermon, because I'm going to do four sermons total on the Holy Spirit. The Christian, without the Holy Spirit controlling your life, is like a brand new automobile that's sitting in your driveway, and it's beautiful. You can get in it, you can sit in it, you can shift the gears, you can hit the brakes, but there's one thing missing. It doesn't have an engine. And it doesn't go anywhere. And there's many Christians that look good. They dress up, they sit in the pew, they sing the hymns, but they're not bearing any fruit. They just look good. Because the motive is missing in their lives. And that's the Holy Spirit. That's the Holy Spirit. You were born again to bear fruit. Born again to bear fruit. You received the salvation of Jesus Christ. Not only that you can go to heaven, but you become useful. You bear fruit. That's what we're going to continue to talk about. Salvation is that we grow that salvation. We grow it. We grow it. The Gospels, the New Testament, the Gospels is about salvation. Jesus Christ, what he has come to bring us into this world. Acts is what we do with that church, it's the Acts of church, of the church. When we get into the epistles and in these writings, it's about growing. It's about growing spiritually, about the Holy Spirit. Folks, don't ignore it. It's yours for the taking. Receive His Holy Spirit. Let's stand. Lord, we sure thank you that you know what you're doing. And now, Lord, help us as we grow. Grow our salvation. For there may be someone here today that hasn't even started a journey yet. They have a planted seed. They for years may be just dancing around salvation, but not really receiving it. Help them to come and receive you today. There may be some more that need to get rid of malice and guile and greed and rid of all these things, because these things keep coming out of their lives. There may be some.
Thank you. We've got some people that are out sick this morning, the band. Thank goodness for Patrick, you can step in and play it. Fantastic, and let's get started with the next song.
Down the next to the dawn. your spirit would be here and that you would touch us and that you would inspire us and that you would move us. And Lord, you are worthy to be worshipped. And that's what all the songs we're doing this morning are about. We don't even know how worthy you are. We should come before you and we should fall on our knees and on our faces. Just thank you for the blessings, for the breath that we have this morning. And Lord, that's something that strikes me about looking at other religions, and that you come and you worship and you sacrifice. But Lord, we come to you and we worship, and sometimes you call upon us to sacrifice, but so many more times we come to you and we lay on our knees. And we lay down heavy loads, and we lay down hurts, and we lay down pain. And we just pick them up and take them. We don't have to come and burn offerings, and we don't have to come and do things for you. But Lord, you bless us when we do. When you call us and we move, and we think that we're sacrificing for you, you take those blessings and you turn them into something. Spirit, we welcome you to this service. We ask that you come upon each person here. I ask that you come upon Vernon, that when he speaks, that you will be speaking through him. And through Kris, as she does children's moment, as she speaks, that you will be speaking through her. Lord, we just thank you for this day. We ask you to guide us and show us where we can serve you, where we can go out, where we can show you to other people.
Thank you.
for those of you that were moved by that and maybe want to participate in one in the future, Trinity United Methodist Church is going to be hosting a Lay Witness Weekend in the spring. And so if you are interested in serving on the team that will go and speak and lead at that church, just talk to John Paul Davis or Brother Perdue, and they can get your information and pass that on to the coordinator that weekend as someone possibly that would come and speak and lead their church in a powerful revival. So note that. And then also for our Shine Street Ministry on Friday, those of you that are helping, and we still do need some helpers, so that information's in the bulletin, remember to wear your green Greenville United Methodist Church t-shirts. If you don't have one, see me or Wendy in the office and we can get you one. But please, we do want all of our volunteers to wear those shirts. So if you have any questions about that, just talk to me, or again, talk to Wendy in the office, we can get you one. And then just make sure you look at your bulletin and see all the great stuff that's going on this week. There are quite a few things happening here in the next several weeks and in through November and December, and then the year's done and we start anyway. So just know the things that are happening as they come up and they're in the bulletin. At this time, I'd like to have the kids come forward for our children's moment, and we're going to come right over here. No. Does anybody want to roll around on a carpet that's got dog hair and dirt and mud all over it? That'd be gross, wouldn't it? Well, you know what? We're the same way. Hey, listen, we're the same way on the inside, okay? Sometimes we have to ask God to help clean our insides out. And we have to tell God all the things that we've done that are not nice and aren't very pretty. The times that we've said no to our parents real ugly. Or the times that we've given a dirty look to people at school. Or the times that we've not done what we were asked to do. And so we have to help clean our hearts out. Just like we have to help clean the house, God helps us clean our hearts. And we tell him all the things that we've done, and then we say, you know what, God, I'm sorry. And then God will forgive us if we ask, okay? And then it's much better for other people to interact with us and talk to us and be friends with us when we have clean hearts. So let's bow our heads. We're going to pray, and you can repeat after me if you want to. Dear God, thank you for our day today. Thank you for our parents who teach us to clean our house. And God, just like we clean our rooms, help us remember we need to clean our hearts too. Forgive us for the things we do that make you sad. We love you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you for coming up this morning.
Ran out to look to see if they were growing. they look the same. And I said, well, hey, growing takes a lot of time. You have to wait. But I think of Jesus' expectation of us. Jesus expects us to grow spiritually. Just takes some time. We have to work off the rough edges. But growing is an expectation. The purpose of growing is come to the point spiritually that we bear fruit. Okay? That's why we grow. Now, I'm going to really do this in four sermons. But there is that expectation. Some may call it sanctification, some perfection, all kinds of terms it's used. But it boils down to this, that we come to a point in our spiritual lives that we let the Holy Spirit take over our lives. Do what we say, now we act. So, we know that a plant has to have certain things grow, doesn't it? It's got to have good soil, water, fertilizer. You may want to go out into the mattress and get some chicken litter. I got some bucket pools and put a flower garden out back. It doesn't make you popular with the neighbors. They don't like that smell. Or miracle grow. You know, a lot of our spiritual lives need miracle grow. And that we really begin to grow, grow, grow. We must be cared for. The weeds, the bugs, taken out. Sunlight. Wherever you put a garden, the garden needs to have 6 hours of sunlight a day. Now, if you get four hours, what will happen? The garden will not grow to its full potential. You will now have the fruit that you desire to have. Same thing with our spiritual condition. If it does not have these things, it will not grow to its expected potential and it will not bear fruit and die. So, let's now look at our spiritual needs. Growth begins with salvation. The seed of salvation. In doing this message this week, I ran across a definition of salvation. It's biblical, but I thought, well, I don't ever remember saying, this is the definition of salvation. This is what salvation is. The word salvation means development toward perfection. Or birth into maturity. So salvation, born again, is a birthing. Okay, it's birthing. Jesus Christ comes into our lives and it's a birthing. Then following the birthing is the growing into maturity. Peter uses an interesting term when he says, it's growing your salvation. Growing your salvation. So, and that is true biblically because in the New Testament, salvation, the word salvation, you've heard me say this before, aorist past tense. Translation is this. You are in the process of being saved. Okay, so you are growing your salvation. It begins with planting the seed of salvation. So the Holy Spirit comes to us by His grace and mercy and love. And salvation then is offered to us. I like the study we're doing, one of the best studies I think that I've ever seen on leading people to Jesus Christ, where it says the Holy Spirit does the work. We're just a tool. But the Holy Spirit really does all the work. The Holy Spirit does the preparation. But we have to be available to get the message. But the Holy Spirit does the work. In this week's lesson, lesson 3, as I was reading that, I thought to myself, you know, how many Christians really know how to lead people to Jesus Christ? I remember this layperson telling me the story years ago. He ran up on an accident, and the fellow was, he was the first one that got there. He said the fellow was actually lying beside the car, and the car had overturned. And he went up to him and was taking care of him the best he can. That time they didn't have a cell phone, or he didn't have a cell phone. And he said the fellow looked up at him and said this, "Are you a Christian?" And he said, "Yes, I am." And he said, "Tell me how to be saved." And I thought to myself, what if that happened to any of us? Every Christian needs to know how to lead people to Jesus Christ. Folks, you never know when you may be in a situation that it's you. But I believe that if you're in tune with the Holy Spirit, the way you have grown your salvation, I believe that every Christian would be at that point that they could lead that person to Jesus Christ. You may not know all the words, but the Holy Spirit's going to give you what you need to lead that person's ready to lead that person to Jesus Christ. So we're baby Christians, and Peter says we should not stay babies, but we grow. The second is this: get rid of weeds. Get rid of the weeds in your life. Quite interesting. Peter says, strip them away out of your lives. These are things that make a Christian unfruitful and unusable. Then Peter goes on and he lists them here. Malice, guile, hypocrisy, envy, and slander. It's quite interesting that, of course, these are the sins of the flesh. But these are look at these. They're sins of time. Our tongues will always tell where we are spiritually. Sometimes I hear people what they're saying, and I think to myself, if we recorded what you said, we played it back to you, would you agree with yourself? Would you agree with what you're saying? That's really the dumbest thing I've ever heard anybody say. I can't believe I said that. But, you know, we do. Listen to what you say. If any of these things in your life, malice, guile, hypocrisy, envy, slander, he says, get rid of them. Salvation must grow. And we must be fed spiritually. Number 3 is word or logos. That's the fertilizer. When you know the Word of God, folks, we have got to where we are right now. We have got to spend every one of us more time in the Word, including myself. We have got to read the Scriptures more. And don't say, I don't have time. you have time to read the Bible. But we have got to reach a point that we take the time to read the Scriptures. Because the Holy Spirit speaks what has already been planted. So we plant the Bible, the words of the Scripture, in our minds. And in similar way, we have to memorize Scripture. And we have to reach a point that in the book of John, that you can say any word or anything, just say it, and we were to tell you where it was in that chapter, what chapter and where it was. Because this is important. This is important. I can't do it now, but I could then. As a baby desires milk, so the Christian desires the Word of God. There's a hunger for God's Word. So Peter said, we should be so hungry that we can't wait to open the Scriptures and read it. And it tells us where we are in our spiritual life. It's water and fertilizer for our spiritual lives. Number four is this. Christians must be careful. I was watching Alice a few minutes ago, sitting back there. Alice is still a baby. Alice has to be careful. You can't let Alice be anything she wants. She has to be watched continually. When we have, of course, many of you have children, you go to a store, it wasn't as bad when our children, remember, just went there. But when we take our grandchildren to store, we watch them all the time. We never let them not. But at home, we never let them out of us like we are with them. Why? Because they may do the wrong thing. They are not mature enough yet that we can turn and let us. No. What is Peter saying about us? It's tough to be new young Christian. Here today, you're a newborn Christian. You're still in the baby stages. And Satan is still trying to lure you away. Still trying to trick you. Still trying to do things to you that you don't want him to do. You know that it's wrong. So what does this mean? We need somebody to keep us on the right track. I think that's not only true for young Christians. I think that's true all of our Christian lives. We need to be careful. We need to have somebody to just look at us and say, man, this is really a dumb thing you're doing. You don't need to be doing that. It's just going to get you in trouble. That's honest. Quite interesting. John Wesley called it accountability. That we have to be accountable for other people, for other Christians. And that's a great thing and a wonderful thing. And most times when somebody is honest with you, with us and tells us where we are, we shouldn't be doing that, what's the first thing we do? We get mad. And folks, if you're driving down the road, and we are, several years ago, we were on our way to a wedding in Rogers, Arkansas. Mary's brother was getting married. No, it was the nephew. getting married, we don't want to help serve the members. We didn't want to go on. There was a sinkhole that fell in the highway, and there was just a big hole. So if people were done, they just got down in that hole. And so they had everything blocked off. What if the secretary thought, it's okay, I think you'll be all right, just go ahead. We're not going to stop you, just go ahead sometime. Hundreds of people would have been killed. And the same way with accountability, where somebody says, you know, you're going down the wrong road here, turn around, go a different direction, you can't continue on that road. The last thing is this. We must have the Holy Spirit dominating our lives, filling our lives. Now this is going to lead to the next week's sermon, so I'm going to stop here. The Christian, without the power of the Holy Spirit on their lives, is like an automobile, a new automobile, sitting there, but doesn't have an engine. Looks good. All shiny. And you can sit in it. You can hold the steering wheel. You can even put it in gear. They won't go anywhere. There's many Christians in the church today that are just like that. We look good. I've come to church. I sit on the pew. Give my offering. Don't I look good? But there's no fruit. You are born again to bear fruit. When you look at the scriptures, you have the Gospels. Jesus is teaching about born again salvation, where he wants the church to go. We have Acts, that's the Acts of the church. What's left? The epistles. Writing about growth. You grow. You bear fruit. Stand with me, sir. As we close today, this service, I want you to just think about your own life today. Back there.
get them in just a sec, man. Thank you, though. It's easy. I got it, TC. Play them. Rock them out. Give me a little solo. I don't know how it was today. I couldn't read much of the monitor as I was speaking. It seemed like it play.
God bless you.